Hello everyone, welcome to our webinar and thank you for joining us. So before starting, I would like to give you my and my company's introduction. By way of introduction, my name is Ishwari. I lead the role of marketing executive in Synergetics. I'll tell you about our company. We are a data center modernization company focusing on transforming the on-premise data center of our customers to modern hybrid or public cloud. We achieve this transformation through four key engagements: planning, assessment and discovery, infrastructure solution deployment and workload migration, application innovation and migration, and data and AI solution. For this session, I would like to introduce you all to our speaker, Mr. Anand Prabhu. He leads the role of solution architect in Synergetics-Consulting. He has an experience of 20 plus years in solution architecting and 4 plus years on Azure Cloud Services. I request Mr. Anand Prabhu to take ahead the session. Welcome, sir.
Thanks, Neetu. Shall we wait for another people to join, or shall I go ahead?
So you can start.
Hello, good afternoon everyone. As introduced by Neetu, this session is more in terms of the cost management and optimization. So as part of this particular webinar, I'll be introducing you and we'll be speaking on things like why do we require cost management, what are the focus areas, certain tips and tricks and solutions, and what's the way ahead. So this is primarily the things on which I will be speaking. So if you are aware, as part of an enterprise, right, there are already enterprises who have adopted cloud, and as part of this particular adoption, there are multiple resources that are provisioned inside a cloud. As part of an enterprise strategy, there are enterprises we say that my data center should be cloud agnostic. So rather than having one enterprise cloud, they have multiple cloud providers, someone like Azure, Google, AWS, and so on and so forth. And these resources at an enterprise level, which are provisioned across different clouds, are also across different business units and projects. These resources belong to different business units and projects. Now, if you look into a typical enterprise, a mid-sized enterprise, for that matter, where there are 3,000 to 4,000 employees, there are already more than 10-15 departments. There are workloads which are more than 20-25 workloads, and each of the departments has their own application which is running on cloud. Now look into this as a complex scenario, and at an enterprise, a cost that is incurred for this particular resources that are provisioned on cloud. Now first and foremost is, how do we manage this environment first, and then how do we manage the cost for the resources that are provisioned on the cloud? So Basically, if you really look into when we are talking about cloud resources on cloud and the way we need to manage it, there are certain management capabilities that are required. First and foremost, are my resources secured? Are they properly protected? Now, in terms of security, right, there are different security levels, there are different threat protection levels. As part of protection, whether my workload is backed up, whether my workload can withstand a disaster, as in, you know, can we do a recovery of that workload? In terms of monitor, there has to be a continuous monitoring that is required for all the applications and the infrastructure on which the applications is running, the networks, what is the bandwidth being consumed. And then there are different logs that are getting created. And if you really want to understand what these logs are and what diagnosis that is required. So when we are trying to do this, what we are trying to do is we are monitoring the entire infrastructure, right? So if you really look into when we look into a cloud management, right, we configure resources, we do update management of the virtual machines, we do automations, we do scripting, right? Now this comes under the heading of configuration. And when we have a configurations, resources that are provisioned, resources that are secure, protected, and then we are monitoring it. The first and foremost is, are we governing the way these resources are being provisioned? So for that, we need proper policy management, proper cost management, and proper resource visibility. So basically, the concept of cost optimization comes under the head of governance when we are doing cloud management. That's basically what we do. And this is how we look into, you know, how there is a spend that happens across an enterprise. So there are servers that are provisioned either by your IT team or by your dev teams. So these are the people who want to understand cloud spend across the organization to ensure the best ROI. Then there are finance team where they need to improve the cloud spend, as in these are the people who, they are more worried in terms of how much cost is getting incurred and how much planning forecasting has to be done, how much accountability has to be built across team so that this cost can be controlled. So then there are project teams where they say that we need to deliver more with the budget we have been given. So there are multiple things, teams that are working on a particular given project wherein we deploy resources, and managing a spend for this cloud resources becomes of utmost importance, right? So what do you, when we do cost management, what exactly does that mean? What are the focus areas? So I'll speak about the focus areas in terms of cost management. The first and the foremost focus has to be in terms of the visibility. So basically, when we are talking about resources, even if there is a 6 months of cloud adoption phase that has happened in an enterprise, or for that matter, a year's time, you can see easily almost 400 to 500 resources that are already there on cloud. Right? Most of these resources are dependent resources. These queues are not known to most of the people. Just the moment we spin up a virtual machine. A virtual machine consists of compute and storage. When we talk about just creating virtual machine, the storage cost gets incurred automatically. If there is a workload that is running, then there is an egress that happens on that workload. Now, these are the different SKUs that are happening and that are being actually costing us when we are deploying resources. So the first and foremost thing we want to control, or first and foremost things we want to understand, is how much resources are already provisioned on cloud. So that is the first thing, that we track the usage and the cost trend. Then we understand each of these resources. We want to understand the spend for each of these resources and whether we, some of these resources are redundant or can there be a commonality. Identify that commonality, build efficiency, or we track spending anomalies and usage inefficiencies. So unless and until we don't have visibility, you cannot track inefficiencies. Based on the visibility, you can forecast. Suppose till today, every month I'm spending, say, around $1,000. The next 12 months, I'll be spending $1,000. Right? So there has to be a forecast. Now look into a scenario where there is a backup being provisioned. Now, the moment there is a backup provision for particular storage, there will be scenarios where the backup cost is incremental. So we'll have to identify such resources where there are incremental costs happening on the resource. So when we are managing costs, there has to be a proper visibility in the terms of resources and a proper dashboard or a visualized data or a consolidated place where we get all these resources. When we do that, we can say, okay, we are able to monitor the resources. And from there, we can actually monitor the split. This is the first area where we will look into, which is visibility. The next area where we'll look into is driving accountability. Right? So whenever a workload is being provisioned, what happens is everyone tells, I need a virtual machine. This is a RAM required. This is the number of cores required. This is the SQL server license that is required. Please provision us machine. Now, as part of a server team or for that part, an infra team goes and provisions a machine, right? Now, does the infra team aware of the cost that happens? Or is there a process where we define saying that, okay, there are different checks wherein everyone is aware about the provisioning of the new resources on the cloud? Because as per the experience which I had with discussing with multiple customers, most of this get into telling the infra team that Azure is meant for scalability. You should give us servers in minutes. Yes, we can give servers in minutes. That's what the infra team tells. But then the scenario is whether this particular resources are being used. The infra team is never aware of this. Most of the team, times what happens is these resources are provisioned for continuous running scenarios, or for that matter, there is a server, SQL server, which is being provisioned, an enterprise SQL. It does a cost, and for 4-5 days, it is not being used at all. Now, if there was a proper accountability built across different teams, we would have saved this cost. For a 4-core SQL Server Enterprise Edition, we may actually pay somewhere around $1,000 a month. And we, 5 days of that cost, we would have saved a good amount of money for ourselves, right? But such kind of accountability has to be defined at an org level. So there had to be a team where proper access is provided. There has to be an RBAC which has to be defined in terms of who can provision resources. And then there is an automatic alert stakeholders, as in, you know, you'll have to configure the alerts in terms of someone has provisioned a machine first, someone is using a machine or not using a machine, depending upon the usage, you define an alert. And then identify anomalies in terms of inefficiency. So this is how you drive organizational accountability as part of your cloud infrastructure. Then based on the visibility and we have defined the accountability, the third pillar, which is of utmost importance, is optimize your cloud spend. Which means if you are running a virtual machine, many a times people from, you know, the development team, they have got used to a scenario where, you know, for particular performance of a workload, they say that my machine or my workload runs good on 4-core 16 GB machine. Do we really require that big a machine? Because most of the time the performance is for a certain amount of users. But to start with, that amount of users are not there using the workload. So in that case, the resource is underutilized. For that matter, a 4-core 16 GB machine is not even 5% utilized. So we are not using cloud in an efficient way. When we are provisioning a virtual machine, the size of the virtual machine should be such that any given time, there has to be at least 65% or more utilization, and under 90% underutilized. As in, you know, your utilization should be between 65% to 90%. So that's an optimal use of a virtual machine. So if your machines are more than 60, running under 65% utilization, that means there is a requirement of undersizing the virtual machine. Now there are many scenarios where you look into the ideal resources. Many a times, you know, there are development resources that are there. So if these development resources are there, they may remain idle for most of the time. Many a times, you know, developers don't shut down the machines. Now remember, machine shutdown has to happen through cloud portal. So they don't shut down the machine. The resources are ideal for almost 12 hours a day, which they are not being used. So can we do auto startup and shutdown on this? Now this is how we can build efficiency and optimize our cloud usage. And then there are different ways of optimizing. One of them is a reserved instance, where if you know that your workload has to work on, say, 24/7, right, for a particular size, and it will be working in an organization for more than a year. That is a classical piece wherein you can reserve those kind of resources and say, I can do a reserve instance on this particular virtual machine size. So optimization is the path to success when we are talking about cost, right? And remember, that's the reason it has been highlighted that it is not a one-time effort, which means, you know, every now and then continuously monitoring has to happen. Your cloud spend has to have monitoring of your cloud spend has to happen. There has to be policies which are being defined, who creates the workload, whether it has been used, and then it has to be continuously monitored. If you are doing this, then I think, you know, you are using a cloud in a efficient way. So that's the reason we say that optimization is not a one-time effort, and it has to be continuously monitored. Now remember, there will be new projects getting in, new application getting in, the user load may vary, right? That's the classical reason why cloud has been adopted for. Many a times, you know, where the resource user load changes depending upon a workload. For example, if there is a website which has been provisioned, and then there is a marketing campaign that is running for a lakh users, then suddenly there are lakh users coming onto the website. There is a change in load. So if we have properly optimized instance management and you are using it deployed it properly on a PaaS service, it may give you optimization in terms the resource can be utilized. Again, resource optimization gets into correct families and sizes, as in you identify the correct families for your virtual machine size, whether D series or E series, or for that matter F series. If you're looking for a bigger compute in terms of gaming, then the G series, and then the appropriate sizes in terms of cores and RAMs. Because this size is of utmost important, because by doing proper sizing, you may save a lot of money. then defining the correct resource and the service types, and finally the cost optimization. So you know that the workload is running for, will run for a year, might as well reserve that. Right, now try and define certain or tell you or reveal the tips and tricks and certain solutions which you can use while you are doing your cloud optimization or you're doing your cost management. Now this is a very classical example, right? Whenever you ask for a workload, you always ask from the dev team what is the size of the workload that is required. Now, when you ask a dev team, they will always say that I need a bigger machine because then it will run in an optimal way. Right? Then you ask your business and the business says, okay, can we undersize the VM and a size lower and can it actually work? And the answer is yes. And then there is the managers and the finance guys who comes and says, can we run it a little lower size? And then even for that, the answer is yes. Now, a particular workload can run in all these three VM sizes. So what size of VM shall I use to run the workload? Now, this is a classical optimization case where, if we are able to predict a particular load and we can identify that, saying that, okay, for this kind of load, right, there will be a 65% utilization of the CPU, then that is the size which one should use, saying that this is the right size of the game. Okay, so there is cost is, so now you understood the cost is the difference between the success and failure when you are doing cost management. So again, this is the scenario where we define, there are different solutions for optimizing your cost. The reserved instances, right? Then whether you can use Azure hybrid benefits. Can you do a right size shutdown and deallocate your VMs on proper time? Are you doing development using your SQL server? So can I choose a SQL server developer edition virtual machine? Because then the SQL server license money can be saved on the cloud because you are not being charged for that. So now if you are learning a workload which has SQL server and you know that it has to be running for a period of 3 to 5 years, so it's better to go ahead and buy your SQL Server licenses and then add software assurance to it, migrate that license to the cloud, and that such kind of licenses which are brought to your cloud are come under a scenario which is called a bring your own licenses, and you can save a lot of money there in terms of rather than spending a SQL Server license which is provided by a cloud provider and a license which you bring in from your repository. Most of the workloads that are running off virtual machines, can they be migrated to PaaS service? Now, deployment strategy also do matters during a workload deployment, because if PaaS service, you will get most of the automation, right? Then you can use certain cost management tools which are something like CloudHealth, which is actually free for at least the first month. Then you have Azure Advisor. Now, when you are doing your cloud spending inside Azure Advisor, you can go and see most of the time depending upon your usage, it suggests you multiple things. It may suggest you either you right size your VM depending upon your CPU utilization, or it may say that do an RI because this is the machine we as a cloud provider finds that you know you are continuously running, there is a good amount of usage, and that's a candidate for a RI. Now these are the such kind of inputs which are given by Azure Advisor. Azure Advisor, mind you, is free. You just have to go and visit a link at least once a week to understand the if there are any findings or recommendations provided by Azure Advisor. And first and finally, the Visual Studio subscription MS Teams. I'll speak on this more details for each of this. Right now, if you have a virtual machine for that matter, and which you are running 24/7, doing a seven, you know, reserved instance for that virtual, or reserved instance for that virtual machines will actually reduce your cost by 30% for the first year. So if you are looking into kind of 3 years reserved instance cost, it may say give you an benefit of almost 72%. Now, if you add hybrid benefits to it, then it may reduce your cost by 82% for a period of 3 years. Now, why and how is this so? So there are something called as your licenses which you had procured, right, for your own local data centers. Now, those kind of licenses, if you have software assurance, you can transfer this license onto your Azure and you can use Azure hybrid benefit. By using Ahab, you can achieve cost savings as big as 82%. That's a huge cost saving. Now look into this, whether when there is a bigger workload, which is SQL Server for that matter, with an enterprise edition, right, which is for a 8-core machine, 8-core 56 GB machine, this cost is around 70-75 thousand with enterprise. Right now, suddenly, if you start looking into doing an RI plus Ahab for the SQL Server as well as the OS license, suddenly your cost goes as low as say 20,000-25,000, and that's a huge savings or huge cost optimization, right? Now, right size a particular workload. So any workload that is getting in, first monitor the moment a particular workload is provisioned onto Azure, first monitor the trend for that workload. So first month you get to know the trend of a workload, as in, you know, whether the how are the workload being used, whether it is work or whether the workload is being used 24/7 or is it used only during office hours. So first and foremost, define a time. Can we have a shutdown on the machine if the compute is not being used? If yes, then use automation to shut down those machines. Right size your VM. So understand the load. You know, where the what is the percentage utilization of the virtual machine during the peak load? What is it? So can I, you know, offload and put load balancer there, and does the workload work on two different machines? So during off time, can I shut down one machine depending upon the trade? I'm saving 50% of the cost. I'll give an example. If there is a front end and a SQL Server which is being used for a workload, now front end requires 4 core 8 GB machine or 4 core 16 GB machine. Can I have 2 core 7 GB or 2 core 7 GB machines? Yes, you can do a load balancing for that kind of machine. And when there is a peak load, so look into a workload which is there, which is running 24/7, but there are very few people which are actually using it in the night or, you know, during office hours. That is the case of one machine can serve the purpose. So you can shut down a machine in the front end and say, okay, let only one machine serve the purpose. This is how you can save at least 50% of your cost. So deallocate the VMs if they are not required. So right sizing and proper shutdowns and startup, proper deallocation of the VMs can give you use cost savings. I already spoke about this in terms of the during the introduction. If you are using SQL Server, what is that you are doing when you are using SQL? Are you doing a development project? If yes, is your virtual machine having a developer edition? Or are you using SQL Server? If you are using SQL Server standard or a web edition, or for that matter, enterprise edition and not a developer edition, which means you are paying for the license. Now, during development, you can use developer edition. Now, that's precisely why the edition is for. So on cloud also, there are images for a virtual machine that are available for developer edition. Stop your SQL Server sizes out here. SQL Server license spend. You can actually stop the spend here. Now look into a scenario where SQL Server license is a 4-core or a 8-core machine. SQL Server license is required. Now 8-core licenses on a Azure virtual machine will be much, much higher. So if you know that the spend, you know, you will be using the workload for 3 years. Can I do an RI first place? And do I have a license, purchase a license, on-premise license by a software assurance and then put it on cloud? It is still much, much cheaper than provisioning a SQL Server Enterprise Edition, which is available on the cloud. Now that can be a huge, huge saving. Now something to monitor a spend, you know, there are tools that are available. Cloudin is a wonderful tool which you can use. Now that it's been almost for a year now, it is available with Azure, and the first month of this particular service is free. This is a service which tells you how do you define your cost, you know, how the cost is being utilized across resources. And it will give you both the forecast and resource-wise cost in terms of, now if you really look into how many there are, so if you look into this particular dashboard, it tells you that there are different entities, there are the cost is across 7 cost entities. There are 42 different subscriptions that are being taken. Now the cost over time is, you know, this is the kind of spend for the last 30 days. So now it will also tell you how many running instance, virtual machine instances are running. It will give you recommendations for RI, saying that if you do an RI, this is the annual cost which you can save, which is a huge cost. Then you look into your projection cost in terms of resources. Now a tool like this can help you optimize your cost. Now this tool, something like Cloudin, can also is a cross cloud tool. So you can use this tool across all your cloud service providers. And it can actually give you an inventory, which is one of the pillars of cost optimization, which is visibility, plus resource cost wise visibility is also being provided by this tool. So using a cost management tool will help, you know, is of utmost help where there are more than 1,000 resources being provisioned. And mind you, cloud something on the Cloudin also gives you recommendations like the Azure Advisor. Now this is a projection kind of scenario where, you know, you can have your service provider wise, you know, cloud provider wise cost. Now if you really look into, you say that my provider is Azure, but how are the resources being provisioned? What is the cost? So these are, you know, how is it spent over time? This is one of those. So when you get such reports, that's the right way to look into, you know, the visibility of spend, and then you can go ahead and then optimize the spend. Again, you know, when we are talking about services, when we are provisioning workloads, can we make it or modernize our application, and can we put that into a web app? Can we put it into Azure SQL Server, that is Azure MS SQL? If there is a MySQL workload, can we get into Azure MySQL? Why? Because, you know, if we are using virtual machines to, and for critical workloads, we start building, you know, high availability into our databases. For example, we start building a cluster. Now building a cluster for that matter, MySQL, right? And that too, always on cluster, it requires minimum two SQL servers licenses that are involved. Plus a cluster, which means there are two machines which always have to be on, so that I can do a failover whenever required. So rather than using this, can we use MS SQL and let the platform manage the high availability? Because the platform gives you the SLA. You need not have to do anything there. You just have to do a proper backup and monitoring. Nothing beyond that. You just have to manage your data. So can we actually migrate our SQL Server, you know, workload into Azure MS SQL? If that is possible, then might as well use it, because it will give you much, much savings, much bigger savings. Now, the same goes with all of the databases, whether it is MySQL for that matter, or it is called as, or it is the PostgreDB for that matter. In terms of web app, if you are using virtual machines instead of web app, then you should, the automation has to be managed by a team or a, you know, engineers like us. Whether the machine load is there, the automation is proper, there are multiple checks. Now, if we migrate this to a web app, we may actually stop the spend, you know, we'll cut down in terms of management costs, because this is being then managed by the platform. So a proper deployment strategy for a workload also can, you know, is a place where you can, you know, optimize your cost. You can save a lot of cost there. And for cost optimization, more going ahead, you can use your backup services, your DR as a service, because then you remove the when you are using DR as a service, you remove the redundant infrastructure. Because when you provision resources as part of DR, you don't need a compute, you just need a storage. I said, you know, using DR on cloud becomes much, much cheaper. Now even that is a part of cost optimization. We can save huge cost for a workload, for a SAP workload for that matter. We have 10 machines running. Protecting 10 machines or running a redundant infrastructure for something like a SAP as a workload, which saves you the huge cost if you're using only the storage part of it and paying minimal, as small as 1600 rupees for a, or for that matter, $27 per protected node. If you compare the cost with this in terms of a redundant infrastructure, it is huge. No, that's precisely what we are trying to tell here is, you know, start using more and more cloud services, you know, platform as a services, so that you take advantages of these services optimization is done by the engineering team, platform engineering team. You need not have, you just have to do little bit of monitoring, that's it, and you can save a huge cost. Then comes the service which is there with Azure. Now this is again, Azure Advisor is again there with Azure for almost a year now, and it's very clearly defined the inefficiencies in your resource deployment. Have you ever been to Azure Advisor? If you look into it, it gives you security recommendation, it gives you cost recommendation, it gives you deployment recommendations, right? Now it defines, it defines your evaluates your environment and tells that, you know, the workload is not highly available, there is a vulnerability there, ports are not secured. The moment the there are ports that are open, right, it will identify there is a security threat. So tools like Secure Advisor will also provide you recommendations. Now implementing such recommendations may also go ahead, and then you can actually reduce cost. It gives you, because Azure Advisor is one of those tools which continuously monitors your workload. Now this is done by an Azure agent in Azure VM agent, which is already there. So they know what is the load that is there on the virtual machine. They will define what can be a right size for your virtual machine. They suggest you even a size for the virtual machine. They say that you'll have to use this size. And they'll tell you that if you do this and undersize this particular VM from 4 core to 2 core, this is the yearly savings which you can achieve. They also say that, you know, we have observed that your workload or a particular virtual machine is running 24/7. They have understood the load. Now they say that, you know, you can't do any much cloud saving unless and until you do an RI. So they will suggest that you can actually build RI there. Now if you have PaaS, SQL PaaS, which you are using, and then if you are using SQL PaaS and for there is a scenario where there is, you know, multi-tenancy is not there as part of a database, so for every tenant there is a different database, so that is how the workload has been architected, then you, for such kind of architecture you can use SQL Elastic Pools. Using pools you can share the throughput across your SQL deployments and you can save cost. So you will have to identify a number, you know, every six Elastic Pools also always defines this, what is the max pool size in terms of SQL servers, SQL databases you can put into a pool, and if you can manage that you can save huge cost there. Now look into a scenario where, you know, you have express route circuits. Always remember a thumb rule, right? When you are provisioning an express route, no matter what, everyone will say that, you know, we want to use unlimited. Mind you, start with a metered circuit rather than an unmetered circuit on express route, because the moment you start hitting the bandwidth, they'll get to know, put an alert on your bandwidth and saying that whether it is there a overage for a bandwidth on express route. If there is an alert that is fired, which means that is the time you will have to move from metered express route to an unmetered express route circuit. Also remember that when you are having an express route, moving from an unmetered circuit to a metered circuit, there is no provisioning. You actually have to reconfigure the express route circuit. Now that's a learning we have learned, right? So, you know, whenever there is a provision of express route, mind you, please use metered unless and until you don't know the bandwidth parameters or you are crossing the bandwidth parameters. Don't provision an unmetered circuit. Now, the same goes with, you know, whether I should use an express route circuit or a VPN. If you have to take that as a bandwidth cost, please also monitor your bandwidth cost on a VPN tunnel. If it is you are paying more on a bandwidth cost, then it's better use an express route circuit there. Now, this is how you should monitor your resources. That's where it says, you know, once you get the visibility in terms of the, your utilization, you start doing cost optimization. And that's what an Azure advisor, a service will, may, you know, give you recommendation for your Azure deployment. Now, this is very classical in terms of Visual Studio subscription MSDNP. Most of the enterprises, they have these licenses, which is MSDN. They have purchased this. Now, most of this, you know, MSDN subscriptions have their own licensing available with them for, you know, development purpose. You can please utilize this by using the BYOL templates for most of the images and use this MSDN licenses on cloud. And you tend to use, actually save lot of cost. For example, a Windows machine, which is normally double the cost of a Linux machine, when you're using MSDN Windows machine key, your cost incurred is of that of a Linux machine and not of a Windows machine, even though you're using a Windows VM. Now that is how you can save cost. Which is a 50% reduction in terms of your, as per your resource utilization for that, for a virtual machine. But also remember that when you are using MSDN keys, these are not for production systems, these are only for their dev environments. So productions, you will have to use your hybrid licenses if at all you want to save your cost. Now, these are more different scenarios where these are workload specific scenarios. Wherein I said, you know, when you are trying to save cost, you start building elasticity in your workload. As a, for example, you have front ends, your sessions are out of proc. That means you can build scalability into your workload. There is an elasticity there. The moment you have elasticity, you can actually spin up instances and cut down on instances as and when the user load. Now this is very, very easy a task. Yeah, but then it has to be properly architected during development. So if you have proper elasticity, you can save cost. I already gave an example wherein, you know, there are scenarios where the front ends, and during off-peak hours, you can shut down most of your front ends. Now, this is possible only if you have built elasticity or architected for elasticity in your applications. Now, this can save you huge cost. Now, there are multiple Azure application services, something called notifications, something called which is queues. Now, most of these, you know, are built inside a VM, can be leveraged services that are available on Azure. And rather than using a virtual machine resource, can I use the notification service? Can I use a queue service? Can I use a service bus service? Now, this is again a scenario where, you know, leveraging Azure services for smaller jobs and that don't need a compute big, you know, entire. Big compute the entire day for only small, such can be offloaded into using PaaS services or application services or Azure services, and you can actually cut down the utilization of your servers. Again, why we have defined a statement saying that always use resource group. Automation on a resource group is much, much easier. And that's the reason, you know, we are saying that use resource group, because there are more classical deployments that are still there on Azure. There are those who are new to Azure. Azure has two deployment models, Azure ASM and ARM, Azure Service Manager and Azure Resource Manager. So those who have ASM resources, they cannot have certain optimization scenarios possible for them. That is the reason anyone who has an older classical virtual machines, it's high time start migrating those, so that into your resource manager you can use scenarios like manage this, which may save you cost. Or for that matter, using manage this can also give you a higher IOPS. Now using if you have a website, are you using caching and compression? If there are multiple videos there, are you using CDN? If your site is having hundreds and thousands of videos, so are you using CDN? Because then you can save much in terms of egress. Now that again, that is an indirect cost, because egress normally is not being measured. We don't take ever into consideration that there will be an egress that will happen. But if there are, if the application has more images, then more videos, can we stop egress happening? Can we have that published as a CDN content? Can save cost. And then finally, when anyone who is actually developing the workload or the development team in house team, or for that matter any cloud development team, project development team, start continuously optimizing your architecture so that you can leverage most of the cloud services and start optimizing the spend. Now optimize the provision based on consumption. So basically, again, what we are trying to do is, there will be a scenario where a workload will be provisioned, right? And depending upon a consumption, if you can identify a trend for the consumption, then you can do appropriate automation for that kind of consumption. You can do an automation in terms of a VM shutdown or a service shutdown. I think you are saving good amount of money with the automation. So now let's speak in terms of what's new in cost management. So before that, let's have a 5 minutes break and I'll continue in 5 minutes. Okay, so shall we continue? So for those who are putting questions in the message box, I'll try to answer at the end of the session. So keep putting your questions there and I'll try to answer one by one once the things have been done or the presentation is over. So now, what's new in terms of cost management is how we look into it. First and foremost, you know, now anyone who is a service administrator, or for that matter a CSP administrator or a co-admin in an enterprise agreement subscription, that is EA subscription, you have nowadays have started looking, you know, there is a tab under the subscription which says cost analysis. So Azure has now started giving you cost analysis as per the resources that are being provisioned. So if you can have a look at those, you can start looking into your contributing costs. Now, many a times, you know, when you are managing cost, right, it is allocated across different teams, and then there are chargebacks which has to be included. For example, if there are departments wherein the cost should be accounted for, then you should be able to segregate your spend across these accountable heads. And that is also possible as part of cost allocation. So what you'll have to do is properly put tags for your resources. So whenever there is a bill that is getting generated, you can actually seeing that this is the cost incurred by you or the department. Then there will be a forecasting in terms of planning ahead. So you'll have to do forecast when you're doing a cloud spend. You'll have to always forecast and accordingly prepare for your budgets, or you may get into an overage. So, you know, there are benefits when you're under credit utilization than under running yourself into an overage on an enterprise agreement. And you can do proper alerting for your resource spend, which can stop much of your spend. And then finally, the optimizations, which we have already spoke about. One more thing is when you are talking about maximizing discounts. So there, you know, most of this time when you are purchasing, you may actually ask for more discounts when you are doing your cost optimization. So that's the place where you start. So ever since, you know, people who are part or renewing, please try to bargain in terms of your credit spend. So are you aware in terms of this particular scenario where, you know, you can have your Azure subscription across an enrollment? So there can be enrollments, then there can be departments. So you can build an hierarchy inside an Azure portal. And the second snap is all about the way a cost of resources is being shown to you. And now there are new cost APIs. So you can write your small application kind of, which can use these APIs, right? So that you can understand your spend. So you can build a hierarchy like this, wherein you say that I have an organization, inside organization, I have departments, across departments or across projects. Now there can be a dev environment, there can be a production environment. And then there are resource group across your data center regions, and then your websites and the VMs under a data center region. So you know region wise what is the cost, workload wise what is the cost, project wise what is the cost, department wise what is the cost. So you get to know all these scenarios so that you can build a chargeback mechanism for you accordingly. Now this particular inside an org structure can build across your enrollments, across your departments, across different account set or across the subscription as well. Now, post this, there is something called as management group, which is newly provisioned as part of Azure resources, wherein you can actually provide your governance through management groups. So management groups allows you grouping of multiple subscription. You can have a nested hierarchy. You can have a custom built hierarchy. And then it integrates service and cost management, and it can define grade enterprise grade governance, and it can define a private preview. Where currently it is as part of a private preview. So very soon it will be live in and available as general GA very soon. So we have talked about Azure cost optimization. Now, how exactly do you see and how exactly you can look into Azure cost? So for people who are not aware of this, you can get into a subscription in Azure portal. Under subscription ID, click on subscription ID, email enrollment admin, and get a spreadsheet, or you can get, that's how you get your cost. So there are multiple improvements across your portal. So for invoices, you can create a billing reader role. You can get an invoice in email. You can have EA usage API. There is a new usage API which is being provisioned. And then you can dashboard using your Power BI content pack. So you can actually create a personal dashboard in your Power BI for the cost spreadsheet that you get, so that you can understand more in terms of, or you can represent your cost in a proper visual format. So Azure consumption and charge APIs. So there are multiple APIs that are provided for consumption. And there are content packs which are available for visualizations and insights. And then there are connectors which are being provided for your Power BI desktops. So all this you can use and configure so that you can see a proper visualize, you can have a proper visualized dashboard for your cloud spending. So what's ahead? So the very soon you will have a unified management experience. The EA portal and the account portal is getting merged functionality into single Azure portal. As part of management groups, you are getting a richer hierarchy management. Then you can, as part of governance, you can have spend alerts inside cost analysis. Then you will have better cost visualization and analytics using Power BI. And then you have tons of API enhancement in terms of unified cost APIs. You have a spreadsheet, which is a CSV support. You have RBAC authorization to view your cost. So you can identify a team and give a role, assign a role, you know, a team member to that role, and based on the RBAC, you can ask him to, you know, download the spreadsheet of cost for you. That's it. So as part of the cost optimization scenario, I have covered most of the scenarios, the focus areas, the three different pillars, and I have tried to explain the different tips, tricks to optimize your cost. Now, before that, before I can move on to a poll, I'd like to answer the questions that are available. So I'm just looking in the questions if there are any questions. Let me see if there are any questions. or anyone who wants to add questions, this is the place you can go ahead and add your questions. So there is a question which says, is cloud in an optional tool or a part of the bundle? Cloud in is part of the bundle, but the first month is free, then it is a charged service. So it's part of the bundle EA price. What else? Are there any questions? Shall I wait? I'm waiting for questions. We'll wait for 5 minutes more. Okay, there is a question from Abhilash. Is there any tool to check the feasibility to move on to cloud? Yes, there is a tool by the name Azure Migrate. You can use that to verify whether a particular workload can be moved onto Azure Cloud. You can use that tool, and it is a fantastic tool. So it also gives you the size in terms of the virtual machines you can move on to cloud and what size to use for your workload. There are third-party tools like Cloud Amaze which can also do that for you, but Cloud Amaze again is a charged tool or a paid tool. Questions though. Azure Migrate is not a paid tool. Any other questions? Neetu, it's over to you. There are no more questions. Neetu, if you can start a poll. Neetu, you there? So Neetu is typing, anyone who wants to share a feedback can share in the conversation window. there is a feedback which is saying that okay, more focused on Azure. Yes, this was more focused on Azure. Whenever we run a AWS related similar workshop, we'll keep you posted by us. So point taken.
Thank you everyone for your feedback. I guess thank you everyone for your feedback. I also thank you for joining us for the call. I just feel on that webinar over here. Thank you.